Good afternoon, radio audience, and again, we want to thank you for tuning in to the Unadulterated Truth broadcast. This broadcast is a live Bible question-answer program where you, the radio listeners, as always, you have an opportunity to pick up your phones, dial the number 281-837-2222 with Bible questions or comments you'd like to make, and we will listen to your comments, and we'll address all of your Bible questions that you might have and give you Bible answers for them. We're going to deal with the subject of whereby when you read, you may understand the knowledge of the mystery of Christ. Amen. Whereby when you read, you may understand the knowledge in the mystery of Christ. In Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 1, the Bible says, "For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power." Ephesians 3, 1 through 7. And at this time, Ozan, he's going to pick up on our subject for today. Brother Ozan.
Thank you, Brother Henry. Welcome, audience. You know, audience, we love you. And at some point, I pray for you, those in and out the church, is that you will stop allowing men to philosophize their way into your heart, causing you to turn your back on God. You know, you have many books, and even in law, books are based on interpretation. That's why you can go to a different court of appeals. But in the law of God, this information is understood by all, but only accepted by few. Look at Ephesians 3, 1. The brothers will take over and do, I'm sure, a much better job at breaking this down. Ephesians 3 and 1, "For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles." Verse 2, "If you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you." So it's given him, and he's going to deliver it to them. Verse 3, "Now this is how he got it, how that by revelation." See, Paul didn't read his.
Amen.
This portion that he is sharing of what was hidden since the world began, it was revealed to him. No, he didn't get it by studying with the other apostles. It was revealed directly to him as he spent approximately 3 years having the Lord commune with him after the Lord had left this earth. So it says, "By revelation, he made known unto me the mystery." The thing about a mystery is it's hidden. So Paul has given the mystery, and he wants you and I to have it. He says, "As I wrote afore in few words." Now here's the result. Whereby when you read, not when you pray about it, amen, not when you interpret of your own, whereby when you read. You know, that's a very simple word. It means to read, to look at it, to comprehend it. "You may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ." So that means that that's the equivalent of a human being coming to tell Paul something, then Paul writes it down. So you didn't hear from the person's voice. You saw it from Paul's writing. But Paul writes down exactly what he was told. Do you understand, audience, that Paul does not, nor has he been a part in New Testament Christianity of denominationalism? I hope you understand that. I hope you understand that Paul is not a part of the Quran and Muhammad. He's not a part of the Tibetan priesthood. He's no longer a part of the Jewish priesthood. He is not a part of modern-day denominationalism, i.e. Baptist, Catholic, Methodist. And the list is in this. Paul the Apostle is not a part of the New Wave fraction, which is of the non-denominational persona, whereby one individual can have seven churches and say he's non-denominational. Seven churches one church, seven locations. See, that is the definition of a denomination. That's sad that person saying that is at a level of low understanding, not realizing they've created a new denomination because it's powered and empowered by them. So when you read this, that's why we in the church look at you and saints in the kingdom as something wrong with you, because answers are read. Look what he says in verse number 5, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men. This was not made known unto the sons of men. So how could you find a book written by Muhammad, a Hammurabi, or someone and say they had the answer? It's not made known unto the Jews. It wasn't made known unto anyone. Not even the angels knew it. That's why scripture said they desired to look into it. It is now revealed by the church. So you have to understand, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles, here's the text, and prophets, how? By reading? No. By the Spirit. That the Gentiles should be made fellow heirs and of the same body. That's two different things. Fellow heirs and the same body. How's that done? Because it was a secret how God would do it. And partakers of his promise in Christ. How? By the gospel. So when you rise up and create a denomination and you try to take the scriptures and tell us you don't have to be baptized, be saved, do you understand that we pity your soul? Because we hold this information. It isn't given to you to know, but it's given to us to serve it to you. He says, wherefore I was made a minister, meaning he wasn't even one, according to the gift of the grace of God, given unto me, how? By my prayer, no. By the effectual working of his power. Who's he? Is Christ. Listen, I want to share something with you. Look at the book of Daniel, if you'd be so kind. Daniel chapter 2. Here's a prophecy we know you cannot deny. I'd like for someone to call 281-837-2222. I want you to tell me if I'm saying this right. Daniel 2:44. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. When was that done? That was during the day of the final fourth kingdom which ruled the earth, and that is the Roman kingdom. That's when Christ set up his kingdom, which shall never be destroyed. He says, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. Now I want to explain to you what to other people mean, and you call 281-837-2222. Tell me if I'm wrong, and I want you to give a scripture. But it shall break in peace and consume all these kingdoms. It shall stay forever. To leave a kingdom to other people is what a king did when eventually that kingdom was wrestled from him after his demise. Other people took over. Just as Nebuchadnezzar lost the kingdom to the Medes and Persians lost to the Greeks, and the Greeks lost to the Romans. And the Romans lost to whatever nation defeated them. And the list is endless. But the scriptures say this kingdom shall not be left to other people. Other people will not walk in and assume it also. You could not rule in the lineage of David if you are not of David's blood. Now, I want to make sure you get this and then I'll be done. You have to understand the kingdom is not left to the Tibetan priesthood, denominationalism, to Hammurabi, his doctrine. It isn't left to Muhammad. It isn't left to Vishnu in the Sanskrit. It isn't left to Confucianism. They have no dealings with Christianity. You have to understand that. It is not left to the Jewish priesthood. It was not left to the Gentiles. Only the people of God who had the Holy Spirit in them were allowed to carry this. And I want to share this scripture with you. And I remember 281-837-2222. It's very early in the program. You have plenty of time to call and dispute what I've said. Get your concordance out and find it. But I want to share something with you. If you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and then I'm done. Paul says in verse number 1, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, we have it. As we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty. Not walking in craftiness, nor having the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth. See, that's what you do. You read the truth. Commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But if our gospel be hid, watch this, it is hidden and that are lost. The only people don't know that baptism doesn't save are the lost. The only people that aren't familiar with how to apply baptism properly are the lost. You have three areas that must be applied: the messenger, the message, and the method. All right, remember the three M's: the messenger, the method, and the message. They must all coincide. They must be a child of God. They must teach the proper message for salvation, and they must submerge in water. That's the only way you're in. Verse 4, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. That's why you don't know it. For we preach not ourselves. See, that's why we don't teach ourselves. We don't talk about ourselves and the degrees and nonsense. We talk about Jesus. But Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God had commanded the light to shine out of darkness. Why did it come straight out of Nazareth? Just like you're straight out of Compton, straight out of Nazareth. The ghetto of the spiritual world. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Yes, Jesus. Had shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. It's in his image, his authority, and his walk. Finally, but we have this treasure. See, this is why it's not left other people. In earthen vessels. That the excellency of the power of God, it may be of God and not of us. So that's why we can't boast. We're just vessels. What kind of pot boasts of it's holding the green peas? You can put it in another container. It's the product that counts. And that's why these phone lines are not ringing, because you know it's right. What you've got to do is submit to God before it's too late. Thank you for listening. The number to call is 281-837-2222.
For those, and thank you for explanation of scripture. I want to go back to Ephesians chapter 3 and verse number 4 again. The scripture that we use to develop our subject matter for this afternoon. Paul says, I want to make sure we grasp this. He says, whereby when you read, I want you to make sure you get that, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Real, listen, I want to make sure that we understand that the Bible never tells you or I to pray for knowledge. If you and I want knowledge of God's word, Paul says what we do is we read it. Now, James 1:5 says we pray for wisdom on how to use the knowledge, but if you want knowledge of God's word, you don't get it from your preacher, you don't get it from your bishop, you don't get it from your mama, you don't get it from your daddy. They are not the final authority. As Brother Ozan has mentioned, the Apostle Paul, the things that he wrote and the other men that wrote, they were inspired, they were moved by the Holy Spirit to write what you and I have on the pages of inspiration. Everything that we need pertaining to life and to godliness, radio listeners, is found in the Bible. What you and I must do is we must read our answer. In 2 Timothy, the same Paul that wrote the book of Ephesians, in 2 Timothy 3:16, listen what he says here. Listen what he says about the scriptures, radio listeners. And then ask yourself as we read this, do you believe that, or is it just the right thing to quote and the right thing to say? He says in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. I mean, it's God-breathed, and it's profitable. What is it profitable for, Paul? For doctrine, in other words, for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, complete, truly furnished, get this, unto all good works. If anybody tells you anything today, like that guy called in last week talking about, of course, I understand he didn't have the Spirit of God, but he calls in talking about, when you see Jesus, he is the Father. You know, this guy, because he doesn't have the Spirit, he is unqualified to be able to try to explain the Scriptures. He takes Scriptures out of the context, which is what Satan does, to develop his own doctrine. Those of you who are running around today believing that there are apostles today and running to these buildings because you hear people on the radio talking, I'm a prophet, and a prophet is, meet me down at such and such location. Matter of fact, don't meet me there, beat me there. And some of you guys are rushing down there to hear foolishness. These people, there are no apostles today. There are no prophets today. There are no prophets today. God speaks to us today through his divine, inspired word of God. You want knowledge about God's will, you go to the book, and you let the book, the Bible, be your final authority. You know, on a couple of occasions, before I talk to the brother Javier, a couple of occasions, even in Jesus' ministry, Jesus had an encounter with one of the lawyers in Luke chapter 10. I just want to listen at what Jesus asked him when he came to question Jesus about eternal life. He wanted to ask Jesus, you know, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? Notice what Jesus' response to him was in Luke 10, verse 25. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him. Of course, he's coming for the wrong reason, but anyway, he's coming. And he thinks he's going to get over on Jesus like many of you think anyway, on fool Jesus. But nonetheless, Jesus is going to give you the right answer. And he tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now notice what Jesus said in verse 26. He said unto him, what is written? Notice what he takes him back to? The word of God. What is written in the law? And then he asks him a question. How readest thou? How do you understand the law? You remember the rich man in Luke chapter 16 that went to hell, woke up in a devil's hell because his life was raggedy. And he opens his eyes in hell, and one of the things that he don't ask Lazarus, who's sitting in Abraham's bosom, is when he going to get out of hell, because he knows exactly the situation is that he's not getting out of hell, and he knows exactly why he was there. He knew that. But nonetheless, he didn't want his brethren to come there. And so what he tells Lazarus in Abraham's bosom, he tells him, well, I got, in Luke 16, 28, he said, I got five brethren that he wants somebody to raise from the dead. I got five brethren that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment. And notice what Abraham said unto him. They have, notice what he said, Moses and the prophets. He said, let them hear them. You know what he's making reference to? He's making reference to the Bible. They have what Moses wrote and what the prophets wrote. And if they're not going to hear Moses and the prophets, let's keep reading. He said, no, Abraham, this is why he's in hell, verse 30, because he thinks he knows everything. This is one of the reasons he's there. He's even trying to run hell down there. I don't want to talk crazy from the pits of hell. And so he's going to argue with Abraham from hell. And he said, no, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. Now, isn't that something? And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose, he said, though one rose from the dead. I want to make sure we understand. Brother Jose has made this clear, that the treasure is in earthen vessels. Those of us who are members of the body of Christ, we have the Spirit of God in us. And if an individual is going to be saved today, it's going to take, as Brother Ozan has just given the instruction, it's going to take the right man with the right message brought to you to help you to understand the scripture. You just go to Acts 8:30 and you'll find now Philip in the eunuch. Philip is sent to this man who's reading the Bible, and Philip asks him, do you understand what? What you are reading in Acts chapter 8 and verse number 30. The church, I'm going to say this, I'm giving it to Brother Javier, the church has never been left to another man. Never. Never been left to another man. Never. And that's people in the church and out of the church. Southwestern Christian College is not the church. Amen. Jack Evans, God bless his soul, going on. Let me tell you something. He doesn't run the church. He is not the leader of Christ's church. Alexander Campbell is another man. He did not start the church. The people of God. Bart Sloan did not start the church. Man. The church is the kingdom, and Daniel 2:44 makes it very clear that the kingdom was not going to be left to another people. Mm-hmm. Christ is the head of the church, and he has set up the rules and the regulations that everyone must follow if they're going to make heaven their eternal home. 281-837-2222 at this time, Brother Javier Frias.
God bless you, Brother Henry, and also Brother Stephen. Concerning the subject we're speaking on, it's dangerous thing today, audience, if you cannot discern the difference between truth and error, between good and evil, between a righteous man and a man that is wicked, between a sheep and a wolf in sheep's clothing. The scripture talks about in Luke chapter 10, verse 25, behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said unto him, what is written in the law? How readest thou? How do you read it? The question he asked him is, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? That's the question we ask to you as well, audience. How do you read that answer? What does the scripture talks about how you get eternal life? Because if you don't have that answer and it doesn't come from the scriptures, then you do not have eternal life if you do not answer that correctly. Man. The scripture that we just read in Ephesians chapter 3, where it says in verse 5, which in other ages, this knowledge... this mystery. Other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. And I want to talk about that very quickly, because it says his holy apostles, his holy prophets. But the Bible also talks about false prophets and also false apostles. It talks about that in the book of 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. Because why? Many, not a few, false prophets are gone out into the world. That's why we have to test, because there are many that have gone out into the world today. Also in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 13, it mentions, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves unto the apostles of Christ. So the Bible mentions holy apostles, holy prophets that belong to God. It mentions false apostles, false prophets that do not belong to God. Because in Ephesians chapter 3, looking at the verse, right under verse 5, verse number 6, it mentions that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of the promise in Christ by the gospel. But the problem in this time frame was that in the book of Acts chapter 15, the Jews were trying to separate the Gentiles from the Jews and make them believe in circumcision in order for them to be a part of the body of Christ. But it was exposed that that was false teaching. Acts 15:1 says, certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. And this is a different type of doctrine compared to what Jesus has done in obeying the gospel, and one being born again of water and spirit, receiving that Holy Spirit, having your sins removed in baptism, which means what? That you don't need to be circumcised in order to become a part of the body and to become a fellow heir. In the book of Jeremiah chapter 23 verse 16, another example is mentioned here about false prophets. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, hearken not unto the words of the prophets that prophesy unto you. They make you vain. They speak a vision of their own heart and not out of the mouth of the Lord. Everything is written for us, as Brother Henry read in Timothy, also in Hebrews 1:1-3, for life and godliness, to do all the works of God. We don't need a false prophet to come up and teach us things, because they have been done away with. Prophesying, according to 1 Corinthians 13, has been done away with. There are no more apostles, they all have died, and all the compilation of the New Testament has been completed. So therefore, we do not need any new information. The book in Jeremiah 23:29 says, is not my word like as a fire, saith the Lord, and like a hammer that breaketh the rock in pieces? Therefore, behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that steal my words, every one from his neighbor. Behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that use their tongues and say, he saith. And you may know someone in the TV community or in your neighborhood that calls himself a prophet, but is not repeating the oracles of God, is adding to God's oracles. And verse 32 says, behold, I am against them that prophesy false dreams, saith the Lord, and to tell them and cause my people to err by their lies and by their lightness. Yet I sent them not, nor commanded them. Therefore they shall not profit this people at all, saith the Lord. And it's a dangerous thing, audience, to listen to a lying prophet. I want to show an example of a man who was righteous. He warned Jeroboam in 1 Kings chapter 13. In verse number 15, it says an instruction that God gave that prophet. In verse 15, he told another prophet, then he said unto him, come home with me and eat bread. He said, I may not return with thee, nor go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water with thee in this place. For it was said to me, by the word of the Lord, thou shalt eat no bread, nor drink water there, nor turn again to go by the way that thou camest. In verse 18, it says, he said unto him, I am a prophet also, as thou art. And an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. The Bible says, but he lied unto him. But he lied unto him. And so, We're saying this because he later died. He was killed by a lion. And today, you'll die spiritually if you take heed to a false prophet that did not come from God, a so-called apostle that is not of God, even a servant or a so-called Christian that is not sealed with the Holy Spirit. Take heed, audience, that they repeat the oracles, because if they are not rightly divided, and if you don't ask for proof in the scriptures, then they'll lead you into damnation. The number to call is 281-837-2222.
Oh, yeah, wonderful. If you don't get what has just been said by Brother Javier, radio listeners, because you want to go to hell and you have your own agenda. Now, you know, you got to go back and look at 1 Kings 13, because it's very clear that this man was lied to. But he knew what God had, his word had said, what God had instructed him. Javier gave us 1 John 4:1, and this is for those of us who are members of the body of Christ. He said, beloved, again, believe not every spirit, but try. That word there, try, it means prove. It means to test the spirits, whether they are God. How do we do that, though? What is the litmus paper that's used in order to test whether somebody is telling you the truth or telling you error? Listen to us, radio listeners. The word of God is the test. If somebody comes to you and telling you the Lord said sow a seed, $100, he's going to bless you a millionfold, that's, you got to be asking the question, where is that in the Bible? Where is that in the Bible? Because God's not speaking to them, telling them to tell you to sow a seed of a thing. And many of you have been duped on radio programs and television programs, sending your monies in to these false prophets who are not speaking the oracles of God, who is making merchandise of you. We hadn't asked you for a dollar on this program. We're not doing this for popularity. We're trying to rescue a soul that Jesus died for so that you as well as we can make it to heaven. There are no prophets today. There are no prophetess today. There are no apostles today. We have everything we need written on the pages of inspiration by God's divine providence. You have people on radio and television been begging, telling you if you want eternal life, as the lawyer asked in Luke 10, they're telling you, repeat a prayer after me. Ask Jesus to come into your heart, be your Lord, be your Savior. Listen to me, radio listeners. There's not one example on that on the page of inspiration. Mm-hmm. Not one. That in order to be born again, you ask Jesus to come into your heart, be your Lord, be your Savior. And because you ask, you're now saved, and then you get baptized. Where are they reading that? Where does Joel get that from? Where does the rest of these so-called non-denominational teachers get that from? One thing Joel says, I give him credit for it, I believe. He says, if you repeat that prayer after me, we believe you got saved. Unfortunately, you know, he's not going to be the judge. The Bible is. I don't care what he believes. The Bible doesn't show an example of anybody saying a prayer after any man and receiving eternal life. On the day of Pentecost, when the gospel was preached for the first time in Acts chapter 2, they were pricked to the heart, and the people asked, the apostles, they asked them, what shall we do? And the apostles said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise unto you, to your children, all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words, Acts 2:40, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourself from this untoward generation. You know what they did? They that gladly received his word were baptized the same day. And they were added unto them about 3,000 souls. That's the plan of salvation. That's the example we can read on the page of inspiration. Can you read your answer? When you read God's will, you can know and you can understand the mystery that has been revealed in Christ Jesus. We leave the faithful saints of God with Romans 16:16. The churches of Christ salute you. Brother, we're trying to rescue souls, man. People have to understand the doctrine. If you're not standing in the doctrine of Christ, 2 John chapter 9, Christ is not with you and neither is God.
That's right.
And they need to understand that. Radio listeners, you need to understand that doctrine, the teaching is very important. Paul is very clear in Galatians chapter 1, though we are an angel, preach any other gospel than what he had preached to them, he said, let them be accursed.
Yes.
This man in 1 Kings 13 that Brother Javier has brought up earlier, he was accursed. He died. He lost his life. Because he listened to a man who said an angel spoke to him. And he lost his life because of that. Thank you for tuning in. Appreciate you, brother.
God bless you. Brother, you know, this sad Matthew 22, one final note, verse 29, when they asked Jesus a question about the woman that had been married approximately 7 times, whose wife would she be in heaven? Matthew 22 and 29, Jesus answered and said to them, you do err. Why? Not knowing the scriptures.
Amen.
Nor the power of God. Now, if they knew the scriptures, Now it's up to them to believe the power of God. They don't know either one.
Right.
So he says, for the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. He says, but as touching the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that? And I said, have you not read that which is spoken unto you by God? God says, I'm the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living.
Amen.
And the multitude heard this, they were astonished at his doctrine. Wow. You know, the Lord says, you know, God has the power to where people don't have to get married in heaven. So they don't know his power, and they haven't read he's the God of the living,
right,
of the dead. So, you know, they're asking questions about, you know, like, okay, well, you know, when we get up there, they act like there's a world of the dead. See, that's and you know, that's what the other religions teach. A lot of them, you know, that there's an underworld where everybody's dead and they just live there. You know, they're all dead, walk around, they're dead, you know, and that's just where they're going to live. But he's not the God of the dead, he's the God of the living.
Amen.
So the people in paradise, that's not the underworld like these ridiculous religions teach. That's where the soul is very much alive,
right,
detached from the physical man. And so that's nothing but live soul. The dead souls are the ones in the lower compartment being tortured. See, they don't understand the difference in life and death. It is death to be tortured.
Amen.
It is destruction to be destroyed. It is a low thing to be rejected by God. To be alive, to have no pain, to be resting from your labors, waiting on the Lord, knowing that eternal life is yours forever, that is life.
Amen.
That is what he calls life.
Amen.
And see, they don't understand it.
Amen.
These guys that are gangsters and murderers and crooks in these nations, even our own, that have wicked people, they don't understand. You never sleep. That's why people do things, oh, you know, I'm going to sleep. You know, what was the matter to me? That would be nice. You think the Lord going to let that out?
Sleep.
That's why he explains to you. The worm doesn't die.
That's
then.
Right. Amen.
And there's everlasting punishment.
Amen.
You're a creation of God and not like a dog. Your spirit comes from God.
Amen.
At creation. You never sleep.
That's
you're
right,
always alive.
That's it.
And so,
that's it, brother.
But when you're being tortured, you're considered dead.
Right.
Worthless.
Exactly.
But the God of the living, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we know that they're still alive. That's what he says. He says, so you guys don't understand. And you could have read that when he said,
right,
because he said, I'm the God of Abraham,
Isaac,
and
Jacob.
Yeah.
I mean, he's the God of the living.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Like you're saying with sleep, sleep is just something that's attributed to these bodies.
Yeah.
Why we're not like sex is, you know,
yeah,
like, you know, like eating is, you know.
That's right.
It's just,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
there won't be none of that in heaven. And so
yeah,
to think that you're going to get up there and do in heaven all that you do now is, like they're discussing marriage.
Yeah.
You know, that's why there is no marriage. There's not going to be any of that
exactly
in heaven. That is something that is for this earth
only,
and this world only, while we're down here.
Yes,
and so for somebody to tell you, oh, you'll just be asleep, be like Rover dead all over, that's
yeah,
false doctrine. Now, you will know exactly, just like Luke 16, this guy never sleep. And it's been over 2019 years.
Something.
And he is still in this same state. I think a lot of folk read this, brother, and just think that, you know, just a parable, it ain't, you know, it ain't true.
No, that's real.
But this guy is still there.
That's a long time.
Lazarus is still
in
paradise in Abraham's bosom. The thief on the cross is still in paradise.
Yes.
In Abraham's bosom. Yeah, so.
And you know what's sad? The Luke 16, he going to be there forever.
That's it.
After the Lord come back, after we go up,
lake
after everything destroyed, he gonna still be there.
Yeah, that's right.
Man, that's like they say, hell
fire
is too hot and too long to go.
Amen.
Too hot and too long.
Yeah,
so
people think it's a game, though, brother.
Yeah.
I think there are people that just don't think that, you know, we can all really understand the Bible like that. I want to know what Paul is talking about in Ephesians 3:4. That's your interpretation. When you read, you may understand.
Mm-hmm.
All this talking about, well, we'll wait till we get there and separate. God will let us know if the church of Christ
he'll
was right. We're going to find out if the church was right or them. As long as we all believe in Jesus. Isn't that crazy?
No.
And that's what the devil wants you to believe.
Yeah,
as long as you just believe in Jesus. Well, the demons believed in Jesus. They called him the Son of God.
Sure did.
And then they say, Son of God, what do we have to do with you? They believed who he was.
Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God.
Yeah, they said that.
Exactly.
And there will be one demon in heaven, brother.
Yeah.
But people think it's a game. Well, when we get there, God will separate. He'll let us know who
was
right and who was wrong.
He'll let you know which way you're going to hell.
Yeah.
Ain't going to be no explanation, no scripture. There's not going to be no Bible study at the judgment, is it?
Ain't going to be no Bible study. Well, Lord, I didn't know. And, man, why didn't you know? Yeah, that's the question. Why didn't you know? I gave you opportunity.
He said, if you die in your sins, where I am, you cannot come.
Cannot come. That's right, brother. Cannot come where he is. Now, who wants to live like that?